Hey, geeks. Let's talk about Oprah's interview with Harry and Meghan, since that is clearly the FOPO news of the week. I feel like Oprah woke up one day and was like, you know what? Let's shake things up a little with the British monarchy. Whatever you think about the interview, I think we can all agree that we need our Queen Oprah back in our lives on a daily basis. Before we start, please hit that subscribe button below and like this video. The Pope visited Iraq this week, which makes him the first sitting Pope to visit the country, which is a big deal. Like, people here are sitting here thinking, oh, did he want a shawarma? 1.5 million Christians lived in Iraq up until the Iraq War, but due to the array of threats they faced over the years, that number's now down to several hundred thousand, which is crazy. And that's actually a trend across the Middle East, where a total of 20 million Christians is now down to about 15 million because of the persecution they faced. And these aren't just any Christians. They are literally ancient communities that descend from the biblical times. Like, they literally speak Aramaic, which is what Jesus spoke. The Pope himself said Iraq is where faith was born. The thing I want to really highlight here, just to show you how important this trip was, is that the Pope himself, a guy who no doubt needs a ton of security, went to a super dangerous place in the middle of a pandemic to tell the world to care about the persecution of Christians in the Middle East and to stop freaking persecuting them. To underscore this point and highlight the extent to which these communities have suffered, the Pope spoke at a church where Al-Qaeda-affiliated terrorists had once stormed in and killed 58 people. And that's just one of the many churches that were attacked there. These communities in Iraq have suffered from years of war, massacre, kidnapping, harassment, and forced displacement, specifically because they're Christian. So the Pope told the Iraqi government that they need to step it up and protect Christian communities. And afterward, Iraq's top Shiite cleric said Christians should live in peace and enjoy rights like all other Iraqis. So we'll see if Iraq's government helps make that a reality. But the Pope's message was not just to Iraq's government, but to governments everywhere. Christian communities around the world have faced horrific attacks for their faith, like in Egypt, Syria, and Sri Lanka, among many other places. So the Pope is basically saying, hey, this is unacceptable, it's gotta stop, and I'm keeping a close eye. So if I were the world right now, I would listen to the Pope. It's been exactly 10 years since the Syria crisis began. Can you believe that? This is the 10-year anniversary of one of the most horrific things, and it's still going on. I was director for Syria and Lebanon at the White House when protests in Syria first broke out. And I remember thinking, nah, this is not gonna take off, because Syria's president rules with an iron fist, and he'll crush anything and everything that comes his way. Well, I wasn't wrong about the last part, but I was wrong about the protests not taking off. To summarize for you in one sentence why you've had such turmoil there and why the Syrian people want the end of the Syrian regime, it's because the Syrian people want their dignity. This is one of the most murderous governments in the world that has inflicted a level of torture and abuse on its people in ways that are just hard to fathom. In the 10 years of this crisis, over 500,000 Syrians have died. 13 million are displaced, which is over half of Syria's population. Nearly 6 million are refugees. 80% of the population lives in poverty, and over 2 million Syrian children are not in school. And now you have a generation where all they know is war. Syria's President Assad will bulldoze his entire country down if it means he can stay in power. So where the hell does Syria go from here? I wanted to talk about this with my friend and political analyst and writer Jasmine El-Gamal, who used to work with me at the very beginning of the Syria crisis when she was a Middle East policy advisor at the Department of Defense.
Jazzy, I am so excited to see you. And I'm so excited to talk about this topic with you because you and I were both there at the beginning of this when it was of paramount importance that we get rid of President Assad. And one of the things I feel like people don't remember is that he is the reason this crisis developed this way, but sometimes it feels like people have gotten used to it. So, what do you think?
Right, so I remember when you and I worked together at the very beginning, and I remember how instrumental you were at the NSC, at the White House, in getting President Obama to issue that statement that Assad must go. And I remember you and I talking and being so excited that that might mean that something might happen, actually, that the US might get involved somehow. But I was also at the Pentagon at the time, and I remember feeling kind of the sense of nervousness because I knew how much the Pentagon leadership was against any sort of action. So it was really this moment of hope and excitement, but also kind of nervousness that we may not actually do anything. It's just a moment that I look back at and think there were so many possibilities, right? But we just didn't end up acting on it.
And now he's just sitting there, right? I mean, doesn't seem to be going anywhere. So if you were to advise the Biden administration now on how to make meaningful change in Syria, what would you say?
You know, I think what gets lost in the discussion sometimes is how much can actually be done outside of the two main things that many people talk about, which is toppling Assad or ISIS. There are millions of Syrians out there who really have nothing to do with those two topics who can be helped in so many different ways, like getting accountability for victims who are in jail, or getting closure on the people who've disappeared, or helping refugees, whether in the countries, the internally displaced people, or opening our doors to more Syrian refugees who can never go home. I mean, there are all of these things that can be done, humanitarian aid, economic assistance to those who need it. And what I would tell the Biden administration is, don't forget that there are still things that we can do within a really bad situation that can help millions of people who frankly are going unnoticed now, 10 years after the conflict started, and we're starting to forget about Syria. And my advice would be, don't forget, people need our help still, and there are ways to help.
I love it. That's such a good message. Thanks, Jazzy.
Thank you.
El Salvador seems practically in love with their millennial authoritarian president, Nayib Bukele. This guy's not your typical political leader. He's more like an anti-establishment guy who tweets really fast. But Salvadorans are drawn to him since political elites there have been ineffective and corrupt. El Salvador had a civil war that ended in the 90s, and since then, the country has just never really picked itself up. Its economy is terrible, and street crime and gang violence are an epidemic there. So Bukele promised to crack down on corruption and gang violence, and under his leadership, homicide in El Salvador has gone down 60%. And that's obviously great, but he's also done some things that make him look a little dictator-y. Like, he once marched the military into Congress to intimidate legislators. And apparently the only reason he stood down from pursuing a coup is because God told him to. He's also defied his own Supreme Court and attacked the press. So, okay, safe to say he's kinda authoritarian. But Salvadorans don't mind that he steps on democracy a little bit, proven by the fact that his party just won a supermajority in legislative elections. And that now allows him to appoint Supreme Court judges and the Attorney General, which could end up making him the most powerful Salvadoran leader in a generation. So a guy like this with that much power, what could go wrong? There are two reasons why we care. First, because what happens in El Salvador and in the Central Americas generally has a direct impact here. So if things there are going badly, then it fuels illegal immigration here, which means unaccompanied minors risking their lives and also likely spillover of gang violence. Second, because we're a nation of democratic values, and so while of course we want to see crime in El Salvador go down, but we also don't want to see the country lose its democracy because that could portend turmoil in the future. Looks like this is one millennial we'll need to keep a close eye on. We talked about the military coup in Myanmar a few weeks ago, and so I want to give you an update on the latest since these guys have decided to act like thugs. Hundreds of thousands of people have been hitting the streets in Myanmar to protest against the military, which has responded by violently cracking down. So far, over 50 people have been killed and nearly 2,000 people have been arrested. The military also detained members of the government when they overthrew it, and two of these officials have died in custody after allegedly being tortured. Now the police are occupying universities and hospitals, and security forces are targeting medical personnel and ambulances in order to arrest injured protesters. And unsurprisingly, the military is trying to crush the press as well. In just the short time the military has been in power, they've made a number of new laws that allow them to extend their authoritarian reach even further. These guys have zero mercy. Look at this picture of a nun who's pleading with the military to not fire at protesters. And as she begs for restraint, they went ahead and shot and killed two people anyway. The US has responded so far by imposing sanctions on people who were responsible for the coup and for corrupt family members, which is great because it exposes and puts pressure on these individuals and will hopefully encourage other countries to do the same. But I'm not gonna lie to you. Ultimately, our ability to change the situation on the ground will be tough. Trust me, I've been on the other side of trying to undermine despotic regimes that brutally go after their people. This needs a response from the entire world. And until that happens, I expect Myanmar's military to continue doubling down. For that reason, they're on my shit list this week. A UN special rapporteur recently called on the US, EU, and others to drop sanctions against Venezuela because she claims they've been devastating on the Venezuelan people. She didn't really go into any detail on which sanctions and how, and of course she somehow neglected to mention that the Venezuelan government and its chief thug, Nicolas Maduro, played any role in Venezuela's dire economic state, which was the case before sanctions were imposed. At the very least, the investigators determined that the Venezuelan government was committing systematic human rights violations that amount to crimes against humanity. At least. And so I thought it might be an opportunity to highlight one brave woman who's been exposing the Venezuelan government's sheer brutality through her artwork. Rayma Suprani is a Venezuelan cartoonist who worked for the Venezuelan newspaper El Universal for nearly 20 years before she was fired in 2014 for publishing a cartoon that portrayed former Venezuelan dictator Hugo Chavez's signature in a way that criticized the country's failing healthcare system. She never wanted to leave Venezuela, but staying there became too risky for her. Rayma has a unique ability to interpret what's going on politically and express it in a super creative way. She's received many awards, and you can see her cartoons and graphic designs on her website or on social media, which have inspired Venezuelans and also given them some humor for some not so humorous situations. Rayma is crushing it, and I hope her work will help eventually lead to new leadership and a new day for Venezuela. Woo! Hope you had fun. Thanks, geeks. We covered a lot today in such a short amount of time. Lucky for you, I can speak faster than the wind can blow. Please hit that subscribe button. Let me know in the comments if you have a question or if there's a story you want to hear more about. And don't forget to use our Instagram filter and tag us. Please follow Oh My World and Me on Instagram and Twitter. Stay fabulous, geeks.